Penguin Random House Audio presents Coming to My Senses, The Making of a Counterculture Cook by Alice Waters with Christina Mueller and Bob Caro. This is the author, Alice Waters. Preface. Here is how I cook. First, I'm at the farmer's market, buying a bunch of French breakfast radishes, the purple fringe lettuces, the spring garlic. I'm thinking about the state of the Blenheim apricots and the Santa Rosa plums. I'm looking for fruits and vegetables that are perfectly ripe, things that have just come out of the ground or just picked. I'm not necessarily thinking about how the ingredients will go together. I'm just responding to what I'm finding. It's a lot about aliveness, a lot about color, the smell of things, the look. I'm listening to what the farmer has to say about what's going on in the fields. I think we forget sometimes that food is alive, that we have to follow that intuition and treat food as a living thing. At this point, I don't quite know what I'm going to cook, and I'm not really putting the meal together. It's when I take the ingredients home, unpack them from my basket, and spread them out on the table in my kitchen. That's when I start imagining how the ingredients relate to one another and how they can come together to make a menu. I'm using all of my senses. I'm smelling the garlic. I'm tasting the pungency of the radishes and the tartness of the vinaigrette, feeling the firmness of the apricots. I'm thinking about the people who are going to sit at the table and what they like to eat, the courses following one another, what kind of day it is, whether it's cold outside and I want to light a fire in the fireplace, or whether it's warm and I want to sit outside by my herb garden. I'm improvising, trying to capture and express the moment in time, and I'm letting my senses lead me. It's how we cook at Chez Panisse. It's how we've always cooked at Chez Panisse. People want to know how I came to open the restaurant at 27 years old. I never went to culinary school. I never cooked professionally. Why a restaurant? Why this kind of restaurant? Why this kind of cooking? How did I have the courage to open it? And the truth is, I never really thought about it deeply until now. I'm not a reflective person by nature. My answer has always been that I was disillusioned with politics and needed a way to make money, and I loved to cook, and I thought I'd just open a little place for my friends. A refuge from the turbulent activity in the streets around us. And this is partially true, but not the whole story. It doesn't completely explain how I came to be the young woman who opened Chez Panisse, how I learned to do what I do. When I think about my past, I see that the way that I was raised and the experiences I had as a young woman fed and formed me in such profound ways that opening a place like Chez Panisse was, in a sense, inevitable. My childhood and young adulthood, it turned out, held the seeds of my own edible education, the values that empowered me to gather a group of like-minded friends and open the doors, barely, of a little French restaurant in Berkeley, California, in 1971. And though I didn't think about it much then, that little French restaurant on the opening night held not only the important threads of my past, but all the deep idiosyncratic potential for what was to come. Chapter 1. Natural History. When I was little, I always wanted to go to the Museum of Natural History and eat at the automat for my birthday. So my family took the train from Chatham, New Jersey, to the Hoboken Ferry into New York City. It was only for special events that we do this. We didn't usually eat out in restaurants, and we didn't go to Manhattan much. But I loved New York City. The dioramas in the Natural History Museum were magical to me. I liked seeing the animals in their homes, like that I could get up close to them. The hummingbirds nestled in their tiny nests, the lions with their cubs on the Serengeti Plain, the little zebra foals. These were the exotic worlds that I knew nothing about. We get all dressed up for our outings. My sister Ellen and I usually wore something my father's sister Doris had made. Aunt Doris was an artist and often sewed clothes for us. My favorite was a cotton turquoise dress with a little pink flower print, pearly buttons at the neck, and a satin sash that tied in a bow at the back. After the museum, we would take the subway to the Automat in Times Square. It was the first restaurant I remember going to. I must have been 6 or 7. Why was it my favorite? Because I could choose my own food. I can picture myself standing there in the middle of the restaurant, my pockets filled with quarters. Every surface of the Automat was shiny. There was a huge wall of little stainless steel doors, sort of like post office boxes, with windows displaying the food in each one. And you put your money in one of the post office box slots, opened the door, and got your dish. Through the little door, you could catch a glimpse of someone cutting lemon meringue pie or assembling tuna salad sandwiches in the kitchen behind. It felt like an entirely new way to have food. I'd range around in front of the stainless steel wall and choose my dishes. Nothing was wrapped in paper, and I liked seeing the food before I picked what I wanted. I couldn't or didn't read the menu, so being able to see it resonated with me. We'd each go for what we wanted, and then the whole family met back at the table to eat our various dishes together. I loved being given my own money, and the fact that I could choose exactly what I wanted. At home, we always had to eat what was put in front of us, but I loved putting my money into the little door. It was my own choice. The great irony is that Chez Panisse became known for offering just one fixed-price menu each night. No choice at all. But more about that later. My parents had moved to our home on Passaic Avenue in Chatham just before I was born. The house was quite old, a little wooden clapboard structure from the late 1800s, with a pitched roof and slanted ceilings in the two bedrooms upstairs. My family didn't have a car until I was 4, and the story I was told each year on my birthday was that when my mother went into labor with me, my father was so worried she wouldn't get to the hospital in time that he put her on the milk train, a local freight train that carried the milk from the dairy farms to the milkmen in the city. And my mother boarded that train all by herself. My father needed to borrow a car, pack up the overnight bag from home, and arrange for somebody to watch my older sister, Ellen. So my mother rode the milk train alone in heavy labor. It was all men around her, and she was seriously worried that I was going to be born on the train that delivered the milk. Thank God she made it to the hospital. Just barely. The Passaic Avenue house was what you might call a fixer-upper. It was in constant need of repairs, with holey screen doors that let the mosquitoes in and peeling wallpaper. My father was forever painting and putting the paper back on the walls. I can still smell the wallpaper paste. It was drafty in the winters, and I was always cold. On winter mornings, my parents had to stoke the furnace in the basement. It was the only place in the whole house that was warm enough, and I'd get dressed down there in front of the furnace while my father or mother shoveled coal. My fascination with fires might have first started there, but I think fire is fascinating to all kids. When I was 4, just a month after my sister Laura was born, Ellen and I came down with scarlet fever at the same time. We were quarantined to keep us from infecting the new baby, and my mother was so worried about all of us. This was right before the polio vaccine was discovered and people were paranoid about childhood diseases. No one fully understood where they came from or how to control them, and so many children died of scarlet fever in the first half of the 20th century. It must have been particularly frightening for my mother, because her own mother had died of influenza when she was very young. Baby Laura was sequestered downstairs in the dining room, which was turned into a makeshift nursery. My parents painted it Pepto-Bismol pink. And Ellen and I were upstairs in the slanted roof bedroom we shared. There was a quarantine sign posted out on the door, and my mother wore a mask around us. Fortunately, baby Laura never caught it, and Ellen and I kept getting in trouble because we were supposed to be in bed and not jumping around. But I did feel very sick, too. I don't remember much else from our time at that house other than the big garden out back. When I was about 5, we moved to another house in Chatham on Van Dorn Avenue, which was much more of a traditional 1950s house, new and white, with green shutters and a garage. When I think about my sisters, the first thing that comes to me is that I didn't know them very well. There were 4 years between my older sister Ellen and me, and between my younger sister Laura and me. And then my youngest sister Susan was 2 years younger than Laura. Laura and Susan were together in one bedroom, and Ellen and I shared the other. Ellen thought I was a mess. She never wanted to share a room with me, and would get so upset about my throwing my clothes on the floor. I maintained a big rock collection for years. Geodes were my obsession. It fascinated me that you could break a rock apart and discover it was filled with crystals. And I loved knowing about the layers of sandstone and quartz, being able to recognize them out on walks. I had shoeboxes full of rocks I'd bought or collected along the river. Ellen wasn't thrilled about having all those rocks in our room either. She was bossy, always. She had the upper hand, and she used it. We were so different in personality. I was emotional. My side of the bedroom was always a mess, and she was so practical, such a good student. I didn't like her much when we were young, mostly because she didn't want to be with me. We got into some vicious girl fights, biting and hair pulling. But in a way of so many younger siblings, I looked up to her. I always thought I'd end up like her, practical, a good student, responsible. When you're young, 4 years is a huge difference in age. Ellen was much more grown up than I was, and Laura and Susan were babies. So my sisters and I didn't play much together. I often felt sort of lonely at home. Susan and Laura had each other to play with, and they were only 2 years apart, and Ellen was with her older friends and was closer to my parents. She seemed to have more to talk about with them, being the oldest child. She always got to sit in the front seat of our green Plymouth, while I had to sit in the back seat with the two babies. Susan and Ellen were redheads, and Laura and I had brown hair. My Irish grandmother, my father's mother, had the red hair in the family. When I was little and Susan and Laura were still babies, I definitely thought I looked like my dad, and Ellen looked more like my mother. I thought Ellen and my mother were sort of aligned, and my dad and I were more alike.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.